can take over the presentation and then start.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, good evening, good morning. I hope that all of you are doing well. I'm Dominik Plattner, the ITTF High Performance Manager, and I am very happy and proud to warmly all of you to our fourth and last lesson of the ITTF High Performance and Development 4 classes with Massimo Constantini, and the topic will be professionals. Before starting with the lesson, I would like to talk shortly about our lesson code, about our rules. To all the attendees, please mute yourself and turn off the video. Just Massimo's and my micro and webcam will be on. Please don't touch anything regarding the recording or our presentation slides. And please leave all your questions in the chat and we will try to answer as many as possible of them in the question and answer part of the lesson. Thank you very much. Today, Massimo and I will talk about professionals and it cover the elite level. We want to deliver you an understanding of what is needed to reach the top level. The class content for today will be as follows. On the one hand, we do have the performance elements, including goals, planning, training, and competition. And on the other hand, we do have the high performance elements, which contain the following topics: strength and conditioning, staff, sports psychology, technique, strategy, and tactics. And I wish all of us a very informative and educational lesson. And now the floor is yours, Massimo.
Thank you very much, Dominik. Welcome to all of you to this final lesson of this interesting, let's say, journey with you. And today we have, as usual, a very rich program. And yes, as Dominik said, we are going to discuss about our very familiar elements about the performance, the strength conditioning, and then we have more things to be added to this. And we can start basically with what is the high performance behind, what happened actually to reach there. And we will try to understand all the interaction as usual, all the things, but always in order to give you the right, we hope, the right stimulus in order to learn more, to get more interest on this, and get at the end better. So high performance and behind, of course, we have a few things to consider. When we talk about high performance, take this analogy. It's like when you buy a car. You buy a car, a very good car, and then you start with the basic, with a certain equipment included, and then when you go higher and higher, you have the same equipment but adding more features of that car. So at the end, the car can be, you know, more powerful, can be more, giving more better performance, maybe more comfortable, more of everything. So we have to take in consideration what we have done before and what we can add more to have the high performance. So we have a few things, as usual, I'm listing. So whatever you see there, it's based on the facts that we normally we see. So training adaptability, of course, high performance is going anywhere to train and then having different situation to face and so on. So different also training partner and everything different. So adaptability is very important. Is one of the quality of a player. The volume, selection of competitions, the importance of the training sessions and the match. Of course, fitness and recovery. We will see again with the help of Dominic facing this topic. And again, actually not again, but this is something more, the expert stuff. This is very important. We will see one by one how ideally could be being high performance player and being the coach of high performance player. So we have to see this in a different way, as a player, but mainly as a coach. And at the very end, we have, let's say, a compacted chapter of technique, strategy, and tactic. Because at that level, we will explain later on, but let me tell you now, it's all together. It's we cannot separate techniques with the tactics, strategy. It comes in a whole. It comes in a sort of performing. It all depends to the other one. So this is very important to consider the player in this way. So we have the conclusion, and where were we? Of course, as I said before, in the previous three lessons, we have explained so many things, and now we are in the final stage, or maybe I put can be the initial stage, you know, to give the final input how to go to the next level. So before Dominic was talking about the performance elements, and you are very familiar of that, the goals, planning, training, and competition. But of course, as I said, we have to go behind those elements, and we have to take them to the next level. Starting with the goals, and now it's time to have expectations, of course, and it is a sort of step by step, but all together. I said at this stage, the things come in a whole, come in a sort of you know, a flexible matter that you have to deal with the players in many different ways. And and then, of course, we have the everyday goals. We have your and partners' goals and competition goals. When we have everyday goals, again, here you have something that we have discussed maybe in the first lesson, if I well remember. It is the consistently tangible. So every day the player should have that feeling that he/she reached that particular goal. Your and partner's goals, of course, training with success. This is another part, as I said before, you know, it's something coming from the very basic, but it goes throughout the career of a player. So training with success is not from your side only or from your player, is also from the partners. The player is never alone. Player is always with someone. Somebody this, the other side that also giving the support for the performance. And last, competition goals. And now it comes the moment that it's not that okay, I lost, okay, fine, it doesn't matter, we'll see next time, I will try. Now expectations are going pretty high. So I would say a very simple, let's say, equation, you know, okay, at that level, I don't lose with the weaker, but I just, you know, I want to beat the higher player, you know, in terms of world ranking. And this, of course, can increase the overall, you know, the confidence of the own status. We've seen the other week, maybe. And but also thinking always to aim something on the top, something better. If in a competition I finish in the top 32, okay, this is next time. I will not accept 32. I want to go for the top 16, and so on. So the next, as Dominic said, is the planning. This time we have a few things the same, as you can see, club and national team planning. But this time, due to the nature of the volume of the competition and training, we have a sort for the player on and off planning. You know, it's you have to deal with this because you have a one day player. Maybe you don't have for the next 2 days because he has other stuff. Then again, we go with the national team. Then again, we have a recover. Then start again. Then traveling, and then the club, and then that. So you will understand that the planning for that player, it's not important. It's super important, but at the same time, has to be managed. And of course, the performance planning, as we say before, you know, when I plan the competition and my performance, I have really to be ready for that particular competition. Either can be the once again the national team, the from one point of view, the club, the individual tournaments, and so on. So you are the coach, and you are responsible, and you have to take care about that. Going quickly on the training, which we have, you know, also for this, we are very familiar. I just put the definition, you know, make it full. It's a sort of, you know, whatever you do in the training, whether it's a session, whether it's a rally, whether it's a ball, whatever, has to be full. So I listed a little bit some of them, and I hope you like it. So successful session, thoughtful session, resourceful rally. I just, you can read some of them, powerful ball, wonderful ball, because of players also, they love to have some exceptional performance during the training and making some really, really unbelievable, unexpected, and at the end, wonderful. So, preparatory routine, let's go a little bit in a sort of daily, what might be, you know, the work for the player. We have a preparatory routine, and we keep the multiples and our, you know, main structure. What we have, so staff is a group of people working with you, with the coach, and of course with the player. We will go later on one by one, but I want to just insist how important is this this element. It actually is a group of people. Cooperation, extremely important for the success of the player to have the cooperation of the other coaches, other player, talking with them and having the same, sometimes the same, you know, feeling and perspective and objective also. So then we have the maintenance. Let's call maintenance is something that if you think a player of that level that comes from what we have done last week, remember, and what we have done 2 weeks ago and 3 weeks ago, this, it's not more that they have to learn something new in terms of footwork. It's something to maintain. Something, of course, that sometimes there are small details can make a big change in the performance of strokes, performance of overall a match. But the footwork is something that it goes in a sort of regular routine, either can be sideways or stepping around, cross legs. Actually, you go to mix up more, but everything is coming, you know, to maintain that status. Your drills, of course. I was a player, and I remember very well. If you are a player, I mean, if you have played a little bit, there are some mechanism, let's call like that makes you, let's say, not happy, let's say happy, you know, or confident. That confidence is something that is going throughout the everything. That you repeat the same, can be maybe two to the back end, two to the forehand. I'm sorry, I don't have a table here. Okay, actually I have a table, but there's no table tennis table where I can show you and understand. This one is just a theoretic lesson, but I hope you understand what I'm telling. Where, you know, the ball comes in a pre-defined, pre-arranged drills, and then you feel, okay, I can do it. This is something that makes me cool, makes me confidence, makes me very relaxed, and I know that in that moment I have to be relaxed. This is coming, you know, to have in a sort of a comfort zone. We will see later on to how to not be only in the comfort zone. Give a free hand. So also players at that level, they have their own feeling, you know. So it's important that there is a time for them to also to think, okay, take your 10 minutes, go on your own. You decide your partner is ready to apply what you want, what kind of ball they have to give you, and so on. So giving free hand means you know, to let the player taking initiative, because when they are the performers, so they have to take initiative. We cannot expect that we lead them from ball number one to the last ball. So they have to take initiative. They have to think in a certain way. So it's important that also during the regular routine, preparatory routine, they have some time for themselves. Open-minded, of course, when we do this work, we have to keep them very ready, you know, to respond to different situation and having the proper abilities to handle them. And then at the end, to have an assessment process. The next part is the multiballs. Also, this one we have discussed several times about that. And yes, at this stage, we can consider essential. If any of you was in a top competition, I remember very well last World Championships where the two players were doing the training before playing the final or maybe semi-final. They were there with the coach, with the training partners, and they were there to try and doing multi-balls, because we will see how multi-balls can be effective, very effective actually. So essential and confidence, they go together. Again, confidence coming again and again. What we can do with the multiballs in that moment can be specific, targeting something in particular of your game, or maybe on the opponent's game and so on. A short ball or a flick, you keep repeating. Maybe you add one flick and one speed back, and anything you can do according to what the player need in that time. So targeting is extremely important. Feeling, it's the fine touch, you know. So in that moment, in the few moments before the competition, they have to have that feeling. So again, this is feeling and confidence. They go together. So it's important that we can create the situation. Can be short return, making the ball two bounces on the opponent's hand, or maybe three bounces. You know, having the feeling that I can control the ball. The ball is in my control, and implementation. So. There are a situation where that happened in my personal experience, where you are there, you have to find something different, something, why don't we try this? You know, we try this, and then with your help, with the help of the multiballs, with the confidence that you can generate. So it's a sort of a trigger, you know, to make the player confident to do even something new, something different, something unexpected, just during the before the performance. So This is something that you can consider. Yes, this is another part to get stressed. If before was a comfort zone, now we can have also to get stressed, to put the players under pressure, and we will see how important it is to get the player with the right pressure before the performance. And everything, you know, to give the player the feeling to be unbeatable. We know that determination and the will to succeed are important to be added in all overall abilities and skills, either technical skills, tactical skills. So remember, a lot of players there are that only with determination, just to feel I'm strong, I'm good, I'm God, I can perform much better than my capabilities. So we have to consider this. Competition is, of course, it's not let's go for this group of competition and let's see at the very end how coming. Of course, at the young age, we want to perform well. We want to win and we want to show our abilities and get a place in the international scene. Now we are already there. So each competition should be targeted, and each match should be targeted. So that's why we call it mental sport, because at that level every single situation is mental. We don't have there is no room to relax. Well, that's changed when we changed the score from 21 to 11. That time was a different kind of mental sport, different kind of pressure. 5 serve in a row, this time 11 points, 2 serves in a row, where you know, you have to capitalize your skills and make as many points as possible and then reach the 11th point. As usual, I list a little bit, a few things to get used to it, win. You have the two areas, domestic and international. Domestic, you can have a certain outcome, very high expectation. You are the boss over there. International, you get in an area where you are one of the bosses. So there are many others of there. So it's not the same. So things are totally different. Working with staff, your performance can draw attention, of course. So you can be, we said the other time, you know, the role model you can be. You have to manage yourself. Actually, let me go 1 minute. 1 minute back to the last week when I was telling you what the player is becoming. You remember maybe? So a player is also a media star. I don't know if you recall that, but he's a media star. Can you just think about Twitter, Facebook, TikTok. YouTube, interview there, interview here, and then Facebook, put the post, reply to that thing. So they are in the middle of a very, very strong interest, and either is domestic or international. So this is a part that maybe we can have, Dominic, we can have one class on this, maybe calling one expert on this topic, because for me it's quite important. And then be professional, always be professional. I added a few more things on this part. I call performance fact. And where F is find the criticality, accept the outcome positively, consider your mistake and the opponent's abilities. Always try to have this balance, remember, you know. So it's not that if you lose, it's always your fault, you know. It's also the ability of the player. So recognizing the ability of your opponents, strengthening yourself, You know, it's because we have to keep our confidence high. We cannot just go out the court and say, it's my fault. I should have done this. I should have done that. Why I played that back and I should have played the forehand. And then maybe the opponents did something great, you know. So it's we have just to consider, at least to consider. That's why I put C. Treasure any experience. I think even you ask a player like Vladimir Samsonov with unbelievable great career, Timo Boll. The other day we were talking with Timo Boll about this. They have the same attitude, you know. So I want to understand. I want to learn. I want to make it that experience helpful for my next competition, and so on. So I would say that time is on your side, you know. So you have to count on this because through time you can learn. So where I'm heading, maturity is the key. Of course, we are getting a lot of experience, competition, learning, feedback from coaches, from players, from your own, and so on. So we are going to be mature and mature and mature, and this is your best skill that overall you can apply in all other skills. I'm concluding presenting this, and then I leave the floor to Dominic. As usual, again, we have the high performance, the four pillars, the fitness. This time I have had this stuff. We'll see how important is the stuff. Sports psychology, well, is a mental sport. Now it comes really, really very, very important. And then we have this Testa, okay, actually testa in Italian means mind, means brain, means head. It's something that's supervising everything. We will see what is the acronym means. So I stop here for now. And Mr. Plattner, Dominic, the floor is yours. Thank you very much for now.
Thank you very much, Massimo, for this great part of our fourth lesson. And I would like to address today the following topics related to fitness. It will be the role of the sport science, the periodization part two, the supercompensation, the adaptational changes, and last but not least, the fatigue and recovery. So as Massimo mentioned before, it's time for high performance, time to reach the excellence. First of all, as discussed in the previous lessons, sports training in general is systematic and regular. That means it should be continuous without disruptions. Athletes should train on a daily basis, and only the volume and the methods of the training should change. You have to be aware that any longer disruption in the training might put the sport development in risk. Furthermore, the sports training is planned and programmed. This fact enables us to avoid almost all coincidences. The coach has to be aware what the current athlete's state is and what they want to accomplish in order to determine the procedures which lead to the achievement of the goals. Let's start with the role of the sports science, and actually it has great benefits because the psychophysical reactions can be better understood. So thanks to the sports science, as I mentioned now, the related to the psychophysical reactions, thanks to them we do understand them much better, and the training adaptation can be much better understood than 10 or 20 years ago. It is the regular task and challenge also, I can say, to analyze the current principles of the training theory and to adjust them to the needs of sport nowadays, and of course also to the new technologies. On the left picture, you can see a lactate step test, And on the right one, a biomechanical analysis, which is the investigation, how the technique and the quality changes under fatigue when performing a forehand topspin stroke. So very interesting topics, what the sports science cover. And today it is possible to develop certain models of the training for different sports and also athletes of different ages and quality that are based on the newest scientific information related to the loads and methods of the sport preparation. And now we are going over to the periodization part two. And I would like to talk shortly about the periodization models in sport. We do have three types of periodization models. The first one is the linear model, which you can see on the left side on the top. This is a classical approach where the intensity and the volume, they remain consistent through the entire mesocycle. This is especially recommendable if you are training one target after another, and especially done in specific requirement sports. The second one is the non-linear or undulating model. It's a varied approach where intensity and the volume fluctuate throughout the subphase. So this is more for the multiple requirement sports and often used for the more advanced training trained athletes, I can say, and for longer sport seasons. And the third one is the block periodization type, as you can see fully down on the left side. It is a training cycle of the minimum number of highly concentrated specialized workloads lasting for 2 to 4 weeks. But what is it more in detail? The concept of the block periodization focuses on breaking down the specific training periods, as I mentioned, into 2 to 4 weeks. And each block encompasses three different stages. The first one is the accumulation phase. This is reaching from 50 to 75% of the intensity. Then the second one is the transmutation, reaching from 75 to 90% of the intensity. And the last one is the realization phase, which is above 90% of the intensity. The goal behind these smaller specific blocks is to allow the athlete to remain the peak level for a longer time. So especially sports like table tennis, which really have, I can say, multiple, peaks within a year. And within the training seasons, athletes will only focus on adaptations they need specifically for their sport. So this is a big advantage for table tennis. And if athletes, for example, they do not need so much of the the general endurance practice, of course, they will not spend such a huge amount of time with it. Beside the fact that it is a really great tool, it's also a very effective method to avoid burning out. And this leads us also now to the periodization periods. And we do differ between the preparational period, the competition period, the transition period, and the active rest period. And I would also like to say how efficient, or also to emphasize how efficient it can be. So a periodized approach elicits a greater strength changes and also motor performance improvements. So in the last lesson, we've touched the topic periodization already, and we addressed that a well-designed plan is the base for it. So first of all, it has to have precisely defined goals. The second point is the plan has to contain all the important elements, and they have to fit together. Third point is a good structural layout. The fourth point is the possibility of the adjustment, and the last one, the economy. So we must take into account a number of factors when we are planning our fitness programs. It's also the individual strengths and weaknesses, the dates for the competitions, the rate of the progressive overload, the fitness components necessary for the performance, and the fact that a high level of fitness cannot be maintained throughout the whole year. So let's start to talk about the preparational phase. Later on, dear ladies and gentlemen, our PowerPoint presentation will be, as usual, uploaded on our ittfeducation.com page. And then you can have more time, take your time and have also a closer look at our example plans for each of the phases I'm going to talk about. So when talking about the preparational phase, it's easily said a foundation for the athlete. So in general, it contains a high volume and a low intensity. And the goal, as I mentioned, is to prepare the athlete for more intense sport-specific training later on. While the specific period, the pre-season period or sport-specific training period, it's more about the anaerobic training, the ABCs, the power and flexibility. So let's have a closer look on the general preparational phase, where 70 or 80% of the time spent on developing aerobic endurance is put on. So also for strength sport, objective is the strength development. For the team sports, only very basic technical and tactical skills are practiced and no competitions. It generally lasts from 6 to 16 weeks. And throughout the preparational period, we do differ between the different strength phases. The first one is the hypertrophy phase. It contains a high volume and low intensity and lasts up to 6 weeks. And it establishes the neural and muscular base, so adaptations occur within the body. The second phase is the strength phase. It's more about the moderate volume. More complex lifts are done first. The multiple joint movements are, you know, prioritized. They are put before the single joint movements. And the agility and the flexibility progression is also there. So furthermore, the speed development is very important within the strength phase. So the recovery times between the sets is based on the energy systems ratio. And the last phase is the power phase. So a low volume with a very high intensity. And the full recovery between the sets is needed. So that thinking about the energy system ratios, the high intensity aerobic activities and the plyometrics power moves. And it also contains the agility and flexibility progression. The goal is to peak the, you know, right before the competition begins. Going over, this leads us to the competition phase. The competition, the competitive phase is, you know, divided into the pre-competition phase. So this is more the early season games. Competitions, they don't have which don't have the primary focus, you know, and then we do have the main competition, the major games or championship events. So when thinking about the competitive period, then we have to say during the season, it usually lasts between 3 to 6 months. So we must take into account the demands of the sport and also, of course, must ensure sufficient time for recovery between the competition. Peaking for the competition on a weekly and seasonal basis must also be considered, especially within table tennis. And the goal is to maintain and also improve the level of, you know, conditioning. So the strength and power workout loads should be done and the practice should be done at least once per week. Often it includes also a pre-competition phase for a new weeks and a new tapering phase 10 days before the final competition, so to build up again the new peak level. And then when talking about the most important phase, the main competitive phase, the weekly training should reach maximum intensity 2 to 4 times per week. So the stress level should be varied. So hard day should be followed by an easy day. And the competition should be ideally built in order of importance and difficulty. Then we do have the normal competitive phase where the conditioning must be maintained. So 90% of the training is sport specific, but the other 10% you have to work on maintaining your conditional state. The technical and the technical and psychological training increases. And this is also, of course, on the other hand, while they increase, the volume decreases. So this can last from 2 to 9 months. And the tapering phase, this is, as mentioned before, normally all the time a quite short phase before we want to reach the peak level. It should precede the final competition by 1 to 2 weeks. The volume and intensity, they are reduced. Not more than 2 intensive training periods within the week should be applied. And in the second week of the 2 weeks, the strength program should be almost stopped or fully stopped. And when thinking about the competition, then we also have to think about the different cycles. And we differ between three types of the cycle. The first one is the monocycle, and it contains one preparational phase, one general phase, the specific phase, and one main competitive phase, where also the tapering phase before the competition is included. Then on the second, the second point is the bicycle. So two monocycles, they are linked together. It contains a preparational phase one, a competitive phase one, the transition phase, which lasts for 1 week. Then again, preparational phase two, competitive phase two, and transition phase two. And last but not least, we do have the tricycle. Three main competitions within 1 year. So the long preparation phase one, competitive phase one, short transition phase one, then preparation phase two, competitive phase two, transition phase two, and then the last one, the last cycle, preparation phase three, competitive phase three, and the transition phase three. And this leads us then to the transition and the active rest. And this usually lasts, especially within the table tennis business, 3 to 4 weeks a year. So the first week is more the evaluation of the current state of the athlete. Then, of course, you have to continue to exercise at a low intensity. And the athletes recuperate from a long competitive period and maintain a general level of fitness. And when talking about the restoration, this means, of course, they remain physically active. This lasts from 1 to 4 weeks, as mentioned, and it's a mental and physical break from sport. And a further increase in the training and competition loads may be expected in the future. So athletes will be able to tolerate those loads due to the following reasons. To modern diagnostic procedures, as mentioned before, to the improved recovery methods, which I will talk later on, the supplementary stimulation of the athletes, and improved preparation conditions, of course. And a highly coordinated and professional team approach is required to prevent the overtraining. Which leads us to the next slide. Here you can see Matveev's model of the periodization. And in the last lesson, we showed you the model for the newcomers. And this time we show you the model for the advanced athletes. The volume and intensity are wave-like. Just the technique increases a lot throughout the time till the start of the active rest. And going over to the microcycle types, within the periodization, we do differ between three types. It's the first one is the ordinary or normal microcycle type, which you can see at the top on the left. It is characterized by the classic distribution of training sessions with a higher or lower load. Training session with medium and sub-medium, sub-maximum loads prevail. It's the focus the focus is on, you know, like readiness of the maintenance, you know. So then the second one is the shock microcycle. It's characterized by a large number of training days and training units with high and maximum loads. And the proportion of these training sessions is more than 50%, as you can see in the middle. And then we do have the relaxation or recovery microcycle. It comprises a large number of training days and training units with low or moderate loads. And it's all the time better to overplan than to underplan. It is easier to, you have to be aware, it's easier to remove the drills or change the drill plan than to add unplanned drills. And related to the progression, the plan, so it has to be planned so that the activities flow from one to the next one smoothly. You have to have the equipment close at the hand and also develop routines so that the participants, they know what to do next to save time. But bear in mind, not too many goals in one training. And also when talking about the training, there are the different reactions of the body to the different loads. As you can see here in the on the picture, the different loads, they cause different reactions of the athlete's organism. The maximal loads enable the athlete to raise the level more, while minimum loads on the other side don't really change the level. And this slide leads us up to the next point, which is one of the most important points within the fitness, the supercompensation. And what is the supercompensation? It's actually the biological phenomenon of the advancement in the trained capacity following the application of the appropriate training workload and adequate recovery. The imbalance in the homeostasis that has been induced requires the organism to reorganize its functional mechanisms in order to re-establish the previous state of the homeostasis. In addition, the organism adapts to the stressors such that if the same stressor were imposed again, it would not be displaced to the same extent again. So this process is referred to the supercompensation. And in essence, it is how training works. And here you can see on the picture, when you are doing the exercise, then a deterioration occurs. And when this deterioration occurs, of course, the level of the capacity drops. Then you start the recovery. Slowly but surely, the subcompensation occurs. Then the compensation occurs. And when before doing the next practice, the supercompensation occurs. While then, when you start the next one, the supercompensation is the last one which occurs. So this is, bear in mind that this is one of the most important models in sport, in the sport fitness sector. And this leads us to the next one. This is the, or are the adaptational changes. Adaptation is a characteristic of every living organism, I have to say. So an athlete's condition is there by influenced by training stimuli. It actually represents the changes specific to the different demands of each sport. So the training, of course, the training load must be over the threshold. It is necessary to provoke very large but controlled physiological reactions. And when talking about the progressive overload, then we have to think about the following thing. Training is designed to progressively overload the body system and fuel stores. If the training stress is inadequate to overload the physical systems, then no adaptations will occur. And if the workload is too great, applied to maybe to do it too quickly, or you know it's performed too often without adequate rest, then the fatigue follows and the following performance will be reduced, even reduced. So work alone is not enough to produce the result. Your body needs time to adapt to the training. And to encourage adaptation to the training, it is important to plan the recovery activities that reduce the residual fatigue. The sooner you recover from the fatigue and the fresher you are when you complete a training session, the better the change of improvement is. And this leads us to the last point when talking about the fitness. It's the fatigue and the recovery. Actually, I have to say fatigue is really a very important concern for all the athletes, the sport. Is your body's of communicating that you need to ease up on the intensity of your physical activity. And Dr. Wim said one time and explained it in a journal review in sports medicine that fatigue helps you to prevent from performing exercise at an intensity and duration that could harm your body. So while high intensity or long duration sport always eventually lead to fatigue, you can help prevent it with proper conditioning and of course also fueling. If we present a recovery method at the point of fatigue, we can expect to reduce the amount of the time it will take for the athlete to recover from the training. Fatigue is multifactorially, I have to say, depending on the type of the training stimulus. An athlete can experience a number of different forms of fatigue. Before we can introduce recovery strategy, we need to know what type of fatigue we are dealing with. So we do differ between the central fatigue, in the central nervous system, or also the central location of the fatigue, or the peripheral fatigue, fatigue occurring within the local motor unit. It's a local fatigue, and the muscle action potentials were relatively unaffected. And as I told you, it's the peripheral location of the fatigue. And it's also about the neurological, the peripheral nervous system, which can be, caused by high intensity work, resistance training, strength and power development, the speed work, and the skill sessions and introduction of new training techniques. And related to the time issue, we do differ between three different types of fatigue. The local fatigue, which is localized related to a specific activity. The general fatigue can be physical and mental, related to the whole training session. And the third one is the long-term or the chronic fatigue. It's related to the physiological and psychological stress caused by exhaustion and overtraining. It feels like being tired, and you will notice a deterioration in the performance too. There is always a very thin line, I can say, between being a world champion athlete and also a ran athlete. The quick question is how you can push yourself to the limits of human performance without tipping over this edge, So there is one answer, I can say. One of the simplest yet most neglected training principles, it's called recovery. And we do have to differ between the terms recovery and regeneration. Recovery is the gradual healing through rest after sickness or injury. And the regeneration is the growth of a new or lost tissue or destroyed parts of the organs so that the original function is restored. An enhanced volume of the work, especially a high intensity of workloads in training and competitions, require adequate recovery during the rest time, as I mentioned before. And the recovery implies the application of diverse procedures that can enable the quick regeneration of athletes and the re-establishment of the homeostasis which the previous exertion has disturbed. So simultaneously with the development of the training methods, recovery methods have also been developed. By the application of these methods, one can prevent the onset of the overload and the overtraining. And actually, I can say, the normalization of the biological functions in an athlete's organism, or also the normalization of the homeostatic balance, can be realized within several minutes, really several hours. It's almost a quick recovery. But the reconstruction effects related to the cell structure and the enzymic systems are realized over a longer period of time, so up to 72 hours after the workout. And we do have different types of recovery methods. We can have, first of all, the massage, sauna, hydrotherapy, so hydrotherapy baths, the application of the warmth, cryotherapy, application of the cold, other procedures, of course. Then we do have the compression closing, and also a very well-known method, the black rolling. And now that's all from my side for the fitness part, and I would like to pass over to you, Massimo, again for the next part.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dominic. A lot of things were there. And sorry, it must have been some interruption of the presentation. Something stopped suddenly. So we're sorry for this. We have restored the presentation as it was with the Dominic topic, and we can continue on today. So after talking and seeing so many things that I can say I'm not alone, So the player is the hub. It's there, and everything rotating around him. And if you are the coach of this player, you have to be the, you know, how to say, the ground control. So the player is the hub and you are the ground control. So you supervise everything. So to do this, we have to work in team. We have to work in team, and you need the expert stuff. I have listed the ideal, let's say, group of persons that start with the training partners, the doctor, of course, physio, massage therapist, mental trainer, fitness trainer, nutritionist, and the trip planner. So we will go one by one, but before, I want just to give you an overview about you know, the roles of the people should work with you as a head coach, where you have the control of everything, and each of the staff should be focused on the area where they have the expertise, of course, you know. So the nutritionist for the meal planning, whether you are in a training or you are in a competition, maybe you have two matches in a row, so we will see later on. So this just to give you a quick idea, and let's go one by one just really, really quickly. The training partners, I put on the left side, you know, how to be a pro, you know. So as a pro, I need them. You coach, you need them. And they can make the difference, actually. So who are they? There can be a player or a group of players, left-hander, right-hander, pen holders, with the different maybe skills and abilities, where, you know, in preparing the player can be a very important tile of the entire picture. So they are important. They can be with you all the time during the competition. Many countries, actually, they have the training partners within the team. So, okay, we go for the extreme example. You know, if you go in with the national team, the Chinese national team, the national team is made by 24 players. But only five at the end will be in the team in the world championships or even now only three in the Olympics. But all the other, they work exactly like the top players, and they have to keep up actually their level, as we were saying before. You know, so it's not your performance; is the performance also of your teammates, in this case a training partner as well. We don't want people just getting annoying there, but they have to be active. They have to understand what's going on during your preparation. The doctor, it can happen, you know, has to be efficient, effective. So the sport medicine specialization is extremely important for the professional player, and he can, of course, advise you on many things in case of injury, how to prevent injuries. Well, one important thing that I didn't mention here is the doping. So the doping is something that really the doctor can prescribe you the proper drugs if you have you got cold or any other problem not related to the activity, but sometimes if you want to go on your own, maybe you go to the drugstore and then you go for a simple medicine that can contain prohibited substance. So doctor is very important also to be aware about this point. A physio is the mechanic, let's call it like that. I like to play a little bit, just please forgive me. It's the mechanic, you know, taking care, all they take care about of the player, but the body machine has to be, you know, fit, And if something wrong in the joint and bones, ligaments, they can be very effective, you know, to make taping or doing a proper action on your joint, or maybe using some tools. Some electronic stuff. There are there many things available for the physio in order to make you recover very, very, very quickly. Massage therapist. This is not only massage therapist. I said this more than that. Normally, is a good friend. A massage therapist is a good friend. He is with you, you know, in a warm up time during the training, during the performance, and then at the end, making your muscles relax. He's there all the time. Just even a few seconds before the competition starts, they are there. They are there with you. And then, as a player, as a coach, we have a very very strong connection with her or him. The mental trainer, mental sport, we have said many times, and think better, think different. So a good preparation in order to be mental fit, but let's say specifically mental fit for that match, for that particular commitment to, you know, where you have to perform. So the mental trainer is very important. It's not easy to find. I have to say it's not easy to find, because a mental trainer is not just a doctor, a specialist, an expert on this matter, because he has also, he or she has to know the matter. It's not just the brain. It's not just how we think, you know, but how we think in table tennis. How we think when we are there 9-9, and then if you don't feel it, if you don't know actually, this is a process that you know, we have to understand. When I was head coach in several parts, I had some staff like mental trainer, and then maybe they start saying, okay, we have to change the personality of the player. We have to change what? I said, stop it. We don't have to change the personality. We have to make the player, you know, ready to perform under certain pressure, where maybe he or she facing the same problem in a particular situation. So it's not easy to find. So as a head coach, as a coach, please pay attention on on this. The fitness trainer, this is instrumental, as you know, Dominic explained many things regarding the fitness. This guy or this person, it's really important to make your body fit, ready, recovering, flexible, responsive, and is really instrumental for your performance before and after, you know, in order to have a proper cool down, stretching, and so on. So this person is extremely important. Nutritionist, I put the underestimated, because maybe we don't think enough about this. We go to the competition, we have maybe 3-4 matches during the day. We don't know when to eat, how to eat. Sometimes we go for some random food. We don't know. We have to take care of it. We have to pay attention. Our performance is not exempt from what we eat. Or how we sleep, actually, you know. So the nutritionist is very important, that can also advise you what kind of food, whether it's more fruit or more carbohydrates, how to recover more proteins, what kind of supplement maybe to have, a banana during the during the match, so many players, you know, having your banana in between the games. So it's well, let's think about this figure that we don't think enough. A trip planner nowadays with such this volume of activities, we sometimes we let the player, or sometimes we do this job, you know, as a coach, or sometimes it's the player itself that going on the website, or maybe having a travel agent friend, and okay, can you plan this trip to Asia, then going back to Europe, okay, having 2-3 days there, then because I have to go to India, and then again, it is our life at that stage is a continuous life in motion, let's say. In between, we have to put, Dominic said, the preparation. We have to put the all the aspect to prepare the players. You see how complicated is this? So it's our job. As a coach, it's not that easy. But I want that with this, you guys, you go back, I don't know, with your player, with your kids, with a lot of motivation, and going tomorrow, okay, let's plan properly what to do in order to, you know, to go to the next level. This is what I want to, you know, to achieve. Regarding the staff, okay, there is more. I know what you think. Maybe you already sent some message. There is more. I will talk later on when we have the testa. You remember the testa chapter? So I will pass again to Dominic for the sport psychology. Back to you, Dominic.
Thank you very much, Massimo. And as Massimo mentioned, over to the sport psychology. And we have to be aware that there is always a relation between the physical and the mental engagement in sports training. So the more complex motor tasks increase an athlete's mental abilities activation. It is also the sport psychology is a very important part of the interdisciplinary approach. And I want to address today the following topics: dealing with pressure, the individual zone of the optimal functioning, the psychological fatigue, and the progressive muscle relaxation and meditation. And let's start with dealing with pressure, and especially on the high elite level, I can say. Some people do think that the reality all the time looks so nice and everything goes smooth, but how does the reality and the daily business of them, of most of the top athletes, really do look like? So in many cases, of course, they are very successful in their countries. So they're so-called national heroes. They do win a lot within their countries, almost all matches. So they are used to be successful and to be on the winner side, I can say. But they do have to face, of course, setbacks on the international level on their way to the top 20. So when thinking about the World Tour tournaments, of course, not all of the players are able to enter the round of 16 or 8, or even for some of them it's difficult to go through the preliminary phase. So this we have to consider. And the third point, of course, it's very high demanding, and I see there is a mistake, sorry for the S. It's very high demanding for them. So they for sure, for a lot of them, there is a lot of pressure on their shoulders, last on their shoulders. And as Massimo mentioned before, it's also about the staff issue. Unfortunately, not all of the players worldwide, they do have a complete staff. So the players which do have, for sure, they have a big advantage. But nevertheless, we have to face this challenge. You know, the athletes have and the coaches have to face this challenge and try to improvise, and also, you know, try to overtake the part of maybe, you know, the coach has to overtake the part of the sport psychologist in some cases. I mean, it's not ideal, but has to be done in a way, you know. And bear in mind, there are just a few exceptions which are to a certain extent successful throughout their whole sports career. Then going over to the individual zone of the optimal functioning. And this is the most popular account for the relationship between the arousal and performance. And I have to say that we, as the coaches, have to find a way how to lead the athlete in the individual zone of the optimal function, or how to find it, you know. So it proposes that there are, you know, individual differences in the way people react to anxiety. So some tend to succeed when the anxiety is low, while others tend to succeed when the anxiety is high. So as we can see, anxiety can be beneficial. Therefore, each person, you know, has to have his or her own preferred level of anxiety that allows them to perform at their optimum. When the athletes are in the optimal performance zone, that means that they are in their preferred level of anxiety, actually. If an athlete experiences too much or too little anxiety, that can hinder his performance even, you know. So the athlete is out of the optimal zone, we can say. And now, as I mentioned before, it's time to find the optimal combination of the useful emotions to get into the individual zone of optimal functioning. In addition to the anxiety, you know, it's about a description of a variety of the emotional stage, which could be either helpful or also so-called optimal, or unhelpful and dysfunctional. For example, some athletes, they may notice that the feeling being excited is not conducive to performing well, you know, while others would say that the feeling to be angry helps them to reach the optimal performance state. Thus, the individual zone of the optimal functioning model suggests that each athlete could find out his or her optimal combination of useful emotions and learn how to reach this unique, I can say, state prior to the competition. But the main criticism of the individual zones of optimal functioning is that it doesn't explain why some people, you know, perform better when certain emotional states occur. And on the other hand, maybe some do not occur. So they are not sure, still not sure. But the individual zone of the optimal function, nevertheless, is a useful model that helps us, or helps the athlete, to improve the self-awareness and the psychological readiness. A common way to find out the individual optimal performance zone is to do the emotion profiling, the individualized emotion profiling. But how to do it, you know, it means that it's a reconstruction of the athlete's emotional experiences related to the successful and the poor performances. So the athlete identifies his or her helpful, or also so-called, as I said, functional emotion patterns by selecting 4 to 5 positive and 4 to 5 negative ones that best describe the emotion related to their individual successful performance in the past. The second point is the same, contains the same structure, but related to the poor performances. So the focus of the recall is either on the pre-competition state or on repeated experiences across the several competitions with the similar outcomes. And then the athlete rates how intense did those emotions feel prior to his or her successful and unsuccessful situation, you know, using the 10-item scale, I can say, ranging from nothing to all, nothing at all, sorry, and going over to maximal possible. And the figure on the left side, you can see the figure 2 shows us an example of how helpful and unhelpful emotions profiling, you know, so you can then later on have a closer look at it. And I will move over to the psychological fatigue. And as you can see on the right side, the psychological fatigue can be, you know, the central nervous system or emotional fatigue. So what can increase the fatigue? It's the training monotony, the lifestyle issues, of course, the heavy game competition training period, pressure plays also, you know, a crucial role within this fatigue, you know. And the new, of course, also new training techniques, which can make the mental part, or I would say the brain, very tired. Yeah. And on the left side, you can see techniques and how to cope with the psychological fatigue, you know. So it can be done throughout the psychoregulative training, the autogenic training, the suggestive techniques like also hypnosis, and of course also implementing an attractive program. And it is possible that the mental fatigue, you know, impairs players, the player's capability to utilize environmental cues and or results in, you know, changes to attention and decision-making strategies. So this can be very harmful for the athlete. So bear in mind to have a close look on the fatigue of the athlete. And I want to emphasize two sports psychology techniques which can be very helpful for dealing with the fatigue. And those techniques are the progressive muscle relaxation and the meditation. And I would like to start with the progressive muscle relaxation, and I will give you a short guideline how to do it. It will take you around 15 to 20 minutes. And first of all, I have to say that it has shown that the progressive muscle relaxation has a highly significant long-term effect in sport, and in particular with helping to reduce the general anxiety and the stress, while increasing, on the other hand, the concentration. Besides, it can be also helpful to reduce the physical problems such as stomach aches or headaches, as well as improve your sleep quality. So how to do it? Find a quiet place where you will be not disturbed. Take a seat or lie down. Increased chance to fall asleep also, you know. Remove uncomfortable clothing and your shoes. Take a few slow and deep breaths before you begin. And before building up the tension, take a deep and slow breath. Afterwards, squeeze the muscle or muscles as hard as you can for about 5 seconds and focus on the muscle you target to tense. The exercise also may cause a bit of discomfort or shaking of the muscles. So don't exaggerate and take care to not hurt yourself while tensing, especially when you're doing it for the first time, you know. You should never feel intense or shooting pain. If you have any medical issues that would hinder physical activity, consult your doctor first, please. And then after that, you know, after having tensed, quickly release the tensed muscles. After about 5 seconds, let all the tightness flow out of your tensed muscles. Exhale while performing this step. And remain in the relaxed position for about 15 seconds and then go ahead with the next muscle. And after completing all of the muscle groups, take your time and enjoy the feeling of being relaxed. This is one of the most important things. To make it easier to remember, start with your feet and systematically move up or vice versa. So starting from the bottom to the top or top to the bottom. And by tensing and releasing, you know, the muscles, the tension, I can say, of the muscles, you learn not only what relaxation feels like, but also to recognize when you are starting to get tense during the day. Practice the exercise for the first 2 weeks twice a day to automatize it. And it can be helpful to be guided through the entire progressive muscle relaxation by a voice. There are many CDs available focusing on the PMR. Besides the positive effect on your performance, your body and mind will for sure thank you if you do at least 30 minutes of mental training every day. And over to the last sports psychology technique I would like to address to you today, and it's the meditation. And it helps you, you know, it has a relaxing function. It lowers the blood pressure and the heart rate, and also, you know, it's about you know, slowly breathing, you know, being inside you. And last but not least, it relaxes also your muscles. So there is, I would say, a huge package, you know, which you can use to reduce anxiety, whatever, any issues with the sport psychology, but you have to do it on a regular basis. And that's all from my side now for today. And I would like to pass over to Massimo again.
Sorry, I was very relaxed and meditating. So thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dominique, for this great stuff. And let's go for the last part. Again, this lesson is going a little long, but I would not take even longer. So we will go a little fast, and I want to show you the last part. As I was saying before, was the testa. So technique, strategy, tactic, all together, you know, in a whole. And at this stage, we cannot separate the things, whether it's techniques or tactics, strategy, and so on. We have discussed a little bit before. Let's go and list some of the aspects to me relevant about this. So analysis, it's called the pro, is the player, my game, speed, balance, risk factor, and the timeout. Okay, the sequence is not consistent, so I will go according to the slides. The first, we have the analysis. So analysis is essential, added value, has to be in training during the training. To training analysis, the quality of the training has to be constantly monitored and self-monitored. So you have to make sure to make the players responsible. We have seen the last week. We have to check constantly that the quality is there. Of course, sometimes, as Dominic said before, the relaxation, but keep, you know, overall the quality always high, and then try to analyze directly what's going on. Maybe some attitude of the legs, or maybe slightly late in preparation, and so on. So let's give a reason for everything is happening during the training, as well as in the match. Of course, it's not only results, you know. So finding the reason of winning or losing, I have to make it better next time. So it's important that I have to understand what are the causes of the things happen. Planning the game to play against the player, match analysis is absolutely needed. And at the very end is the tools for analysis. So when I was telling you before regarding the staff, yes, it can be an analyst on for training and match can be done in many different ways. Of course, the first is the coach that going straight to the player and you know, giving the feedback, getting feedback from the player as well. Sometimes getting feedback from other people watching, you know, maybe you have some colleagues. What do you think about that? How did you see that match? You know, something like that. And then you can have a different kind of analysis for, as I said, for the performance, for the fitness, psychological, and so on. So we can use the camera or more cameras nowadays. We have seen the other time each player going there with their own camera, or maybe the smartphone, setting up with the stand in the middle, in the corner, wherever, you know, they think is the best, and then they record. Many players, they just watch, you know, the match, just a few during, even in the bench, you know, watching the match and then going, okay, I have to do this. Everything coming from the planning the match, but this is coming because you you have a good analysis of the things. So it's absolutely needed for those players to perform. So there can be software, of course, elaborated. We have seen many times in China there is this group of people, you know, being there and taking notes with the stats, with the heart rate control, and many other things. So we can have many different tools where we can be at our disposal to use and to have the best performance. And then also the outsourcing experts. So there are nowadays people doing this actually important part of the performance of the players. So please consider. My game, of course, is the best tactic ever to play my game. BFF is the best friend forever. So it is with you all the time. Don't take it for granted, you know. I just put a question for you, you know. Do you what's going on? Something wrong today? What happened? Please keep don't take any action, please. The game, I was telling about the game. Don't take for granted that your game is always played at your best. I was just to think about when you can see the champion and with the great champion. I have some example to give you, you know. So there are some situation where you are a strong player. You play with the weaker player, and what you do? Okay, because he's weak, I have a margin, I can, I can play, I can relax, I can go lobbying or fishing, and I don't play my game. A champion, a super champion, it doesn't care who is on the other side. He's going, if he can win 11-0, he will win 11-0. And we have seen actually in the super top players, if you remember that final, the women's final in Budapest between Liu Shiwen and Chen Meng, one game finished 11-0, you know. And at the end, she said, you know, I don't want to get distracted even one point. I want to keep my focus. I want to keep, and this is not a great mentality. It's a wonderful mentality. It's how it should be. But this is something coming also from young players. I said the other week. So the discipline of the playing your game, it's absolutely, absolutely important. So, and this coming the winning mentality, I was just saying, you know. So even it is an abused term, the winning mentality should always be expressed, no exception, in training, in competition, whether it is a weak player or a regular player, whoever is there, just go straight, give the proper mentality to your player. So one by one, but together, I put, when you work with professional, you have to consider as a whole entity, as I said before. So remember this, everything is connected. If something doesn't work, you just don't consider that problem. Just think about maybe something before happened, maybe something coming from a previous. If I lose a rally and maybe I miss the last ball, maybe it's not because I missed the last ball, maybe because the previous ball was not played well and the opponents did a good job and I missed the last ball. So let's consider everything. Don't take it for granted, as I said before. Speed. It's in our brain is a Formula One speed, And it's not what you think, you know, that you have to go super fast. It's a smart speed. So a professional player is a player that calculates, let's say like that, in a very, very short time. So speed of mind, you don't have to make a lot of process elaboration. Okay, if I do this, I can do that. But if I do that, I can do this and then back again. Or maybe I can, by the time you lose the game, you lose the match. So everything happened in nothing. And this is the great part of a professional player, you know, to calculate, to create the condition, and by the time they perform, they create opportunity maybe to perform even better, or maybe they calculate to give a certain ball in order to be prepared for the other one. So there is a smart speed inside, and your brain goes absolutely at super fast and always focus to make the best use of your skill. Balance. We have discussed in the previous classes the balance where other can make it. I call it the perfect imperfection. Please let me pass this. I like it very much, actually. So the balance is something, you know, that it expresses the every movement, everything you do, even you walk. You walk, you lose for a very short time the balance to recover with the next step and so on. So sometimes it's a very natural action. In table tennis, is something that you develop time to time. If we have done a good job before, we will have players performing unbelievable great by using this specific skill. So the good performance of a stroke involves the restoration of the balance, as I was saying before. So if I lose the balance by hitting the ball with the forehand, and then I'm not able to restore the balance and get ready for the next. So the balance is that skill that gives me the ability to make things continuing. So not having a stop is walking, is running. So table tennis, which is not a cyclic sport, we have somehow to do this incredible thing, which is making cyclic. So it's a little extreme. I understand. That's why I call it perfect imperfection. But it is like that, guys. It is like that. So if you watch the top players, sometimes we watch our regular player, you know, and they perform in a incredibly with a very poor balance, maybe with one leg, maybe with the center of gravity extremely low, and maybe close to the floor. That is incredible what they can do, and we have to count on this. We have actually to count. This is a very, very special ability, you know. Where you can really perform something exceptional through this can be done, of course, in a different situation, but also during the training. You remember before I was saying, you know, make the wonderful ball. You know, sometimes we do think, because our target is always the same. You know, we want to do better. We want to make it better. We want to perform better. Confidence. So everything rotated with that. So we try our best to perform in that way. So risk factor is also, you know, is something again that look behind. I put look behind. It's conventional and unconventional. You have to accept, you have to take it as something pleasant, you know. So because the players are there, they have that feeling, you know, it's not that we can, you know, we can, yes, we can advise them, but we cannot impose them to say, risk the next ball, you do something crazy, you do something. It's not working like that. It's very connected, you know, with several factors, you know. So the anticipation skill, remember, the tactical need. Maybe you can give some sort of a message to the opponent, you know, surprising the opponents and so on. It is dictated by the desire to amaze oneself. So you want to actually, in the very topic moment, you want to test yourself. Can you imagine? You want to test yourself because it's your inside battle. You know, you want to show something absolutely exceptional. The pro that was in the beginning, of course, is the highest meaning. Pro at the pro level, as usual. How is the techniques of a pro? This is a very very interesting question. You know, it is something well defined as a flexible in its expression. So the ability to do so many things in a very short time, using the proper techniques, sometimes using wrong techniques. Can you imagine using wrong techniques? So it all part of how they can make the best use of the technique. Let's start with we have a few things. We have just three. Impact on the ball. They have this amazing ability, you know, to manage the ball from zero power, zero speed to maximum speed, to end speed. From zero spin to end spin. It's not just speed, it's not just spin, but they have this ability, you know, to calculate, to handle, to give a sort of, you know, power, like the volume of the loudspeaker, you know, you can adjust, and this is the pro, you know, this is how they can make the impact of the ball superpower that from outside we can say that is wrong, you know, they have hit the ball too harsh, and how can this can go, but they have the ability to handle it. So maybe if made by a kid, maybe we have to pay attention, because they are in a PhD, they are in the university, they are not in the primary school. So remember what they have done in the past, and then is coming to perform in this moment. Similarly, is the kindness of a touch, you know. So again, it's not the feeling. Yes, normally we consider them, oh, they have a great feeling. It's more than that. It's really more than that. Is the perception. Is the perception to give the proper touch on the ball, with sometimes relaxed the wrist, squeezing the grip, relaxing the grip, squeezing the shoulder. Their body is the tool. I don't know how to explain. It is like that. It is unbelievable like that. And the last part is the connection. Again, technique doesn't come by chance. It all connected. As if we have done a good work before, you know, using the ability to keep going, to not to stop in between. The other day I was watching some good players a video, and then I was saying, this guy cannot make that point. I didn't watch before, so I didn't know. He cannot make that point because he was late ball after ball. In fact, he lost the point. He could not reach that that ball because he was not able, no, she was not able to connect all of them because she stopped in between. And if you don't connect the things, you are not able to perform. So yeah, I ended. You know, whoever stops is lost. So it's something like that. So we have the last is the timeout. I would say the unknown, unexplored territory, actually. So can you think about, we don't train for a timeout because we think that is something comes. Something that appears, you know, magically. We don't know when. Maybe we don't even prepare this. We can create some scenarios, some mental scenarios as a coach or players. Sometimes is the player that goes, time out. They leave the racket over there. They go back to the bench without giving any sign to the umpires that they don't understand who called the timeout. No, that player. Maybe it's that player. So they get confused. So it's wrong. And please teach them to give a proper sign to do the timeout properly. It's not just a moment of, you know, losing the temper. Okay, timeout. It's not like that. So we don't actually train. Normally, we can do this, you know. So we can make them during the training session, even the 6 points toweling. Have you ever seen the players doing match training in the training venue and then stop every 6 points? Maybe some. So when we have a training match in the venue, let's do it properly. Having 6 point toweling. You want to stop maybe 10-8, it was 10-6, 10-8. Okay, timeout, take them out. So we have to create the situation, which is not difficult, super difficult to create the competition situation in the training hall. So let's also start with this. When to call the timeout? Maybe after a negative sequence, I lose 3, 4, 5 points in a row. I'm a coach. Okay, I can feel it. Okay, maybe he can make it now. No, it doesn't make. Or maybe he can make it now. No, it doesn't make. Okay, timeout. Or maybe a match point with your match point, maybe sometimes with the opponent's match point. In the beginning of the game, in the middle of the game, losing 3-0, timeout, please timeout. Or during the decider, you know, the last game. So it's very much relating with the feeling. Why to call the timeout? Yes, restoring the focus, of course, finding a new solution. I'm not able to come out to this situation. Maybe preparing a surprise, recall, making the player calm, and then making thinking better. Okay, you know that now, you know, he's stepping around a lot. Why don't you play a couple of balls on the forehand and then try to, you know, get back to the situation, get control of the ball and so on. So we call the timeout for a different situation. I just put some questions there, but you are familiar with this and you can think about. And then this is another part, with my serve, with the opponent's serve, in between, there are some mechanisms, they're not the same, you know. So after 1 minute of timeout, and maybe you have done your serve, and then after 1 minute, you have to perform a good serve. After a break of 1 minute, sometimes I would dare that maybe 9 out of 10, the serve will be long. There is not that feeling that, you know, thing that going fluently. It's an interruption. So being an interruption can create some destabilization. So maybe calling the timeout in the opponent's sequence in between, this is maybe can be a good solution, thinking to use the timeout also for that one. And well, we can think different situation. As I said, actually there are only three, with my serve, with the other serve, in between mine, in between their serve. And I think I stop here. This is this was the last. Actually, I have one more last thought. Well, of course, learning, apply, testing, how to coach. You know, improvement. You can improve like players. So know your players, please have in mind to improve all the time. Well, I conclude before giving back the words to Dominic, this cycle of four. I hope you like them. You can put all four together. You can review, you can write us. If you notice, each topic we have touched can generate more classes, more lessons. So maybe in future we will have more lessons of each topic. So we have ideas. If you want to send us your ideas, very welcome. We are here to help you. So let me thank the entire high performance and development team that is behind this huge work. I have to say, Polona is the backbone of our department. Thank you, Polona. Dominic, great help, good contribution, amazing from your side. Dora, you are on the back as try to adjust everything, the presentation, not important, super important. Cassia, you are there always with your expertise during the calls and so on. Thank you very much, Cassia. Moncho, you make me so comfortable. Thank you very much for your for existing. And yes, this work is dedicated to all coaches of the world. And with this, I stop. I thank you very much one more time. And back to you, Dominic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Massimo, for sharing with us your knowledge and the ideas regarding how to work with the players on the pro level. So, grazie mille, Max. And I want to thank all of you for your interest and attendance, and we hope that we could have helped you with the four lessons. Respectively, maybe we have strengthened your current way, your coaching methods, and giving you new ideas how to work with the different age and level categories. Stay tuned for future initiative of the ITTF High Performance and Development Team. And I would also like to thank all the entire ITTF High Performance and Development Team for the great job. And that's all from my side for today, and pass over to you, Max, and I kindly ask you for the very last closing words.
Yeah, well, after all this, really, it was a great four weeks, intense work. Trust me, we have put not only the knowledge, something behind the knowledge, in order to give you the best of us. And now we will take a break. It's the summer, it's August, but more initiative will come in future. Again and again, thank you very much. Have a great summer. Please be safe, healthy, and love table tennis. And ciao.
Have a great summer. Ciao. Bye.